Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Amen. I ain't afraid of nobody. Amen. As long as I got God by my side. Is that all right? We come this morning to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, for he is worthy to be praised. Is that all right, church? I said, is that all right, church? Amen. Amen. God has been good to us. He spared us one more time. Amen. So we owe him all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. Amen. Jason, I don't know what you come to do. Amen. Reverend Garrett, I don't know what you come to do. Amen. Cameron, good to see you. I don't know what you come to do. Delana, I don't know what you come to do. Amen. 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 I don't know what you come to do.
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 I come to lift him up. 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 Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you. I come to praise his name. I come to praise his name. Well, I come to praise his name. And I come to praise his name. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you. I come to hear the word. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you. I come to do my dance. I come to do my dance. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you.
You and you and you and you.
I come to stomp my feet. And I come to stomp my feet. And I come to stomp my feet. And I come to stomp my feet. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you.
You and you and you.
I come to hear the word. And I come to hear the word. And I come to hear the word. Well, I come to hear the word. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you.
You and you and you and you.
I come to jump and shout. I come to jump and shout. Well, I come to jump and shout. I come to jump and shout. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
You and you and you and you.
You and you and you and you.
I come to clap my hands. Well, I come to clap my hands. Well, I come to clap my hands. Now I come to clap my hands. Well, I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
I don't know what you come to do.
I come to praise his name.
I come to do my dance. come to lift him up. Well, I come to sing a song. And I come to praise his name. And I come to praise his name. I come to lift him up. And I come to stomp my feet. And I come to do my dance. And I come to do my dance. And I came to hear the word. And I came to hear the word. Well, I don't know what you come to do. You and you and you and you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Yes, sir. This morning's scripture will be coming from the 26th chapter of Matthew.
Yes, sir.
Starting at verse 14. The 26th chapter of Matthew, starting at verse 14. And it reads, "Then one of the 12, whose name was Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and said, 'What will you give me if I deliver him over to you?' Then they paid him 30 pieces of silver.
Yes.
And from that moment, he sought an opportunity to betray him.
Yes, Lord.
Now on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, 'Where will ye have us prepare for you to eat the Passover?' He said, 'Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, the teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.' And the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at the table with the 12, and as they were eating, he said, 'Truly I say unto you, one of you will betray me.' And they were very sorrowful and began to say to him, one after another,
'Yes, sir.
Is it I?'
Is it I?
He answered, 'Who he who has dipped in his hand in the dish with me will betray me.
Yes, sir.
The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to the man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for him, that man, if he had not been born.'" May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word.
Amen.
Pray deep.
Yes, sir.
Dear Heavenly Father, come to you this morning in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Asking you, Lord, to forgive us of our many sins. Thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning and letting us see a new day. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come to your house once again.
Thank you.
Praise your name, Lord, and say thank you.
Thank you.
For keeping us this week, Lord. We say thank you, Lord, that we haven't gotten sick yet. We say thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Lord, just guiding us along the way, Lord, and holding our hands along the way.
Yes.
We say thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
For having food on our table.
Yes.
We say thank you, Lord. For
thank you, Lord.
A shelter over our head. Thank you, Lord, for having a party drive to get from place to place. But most of all, Lord, we say thank you for having a church that we come to.
Well, thank
Lord,
you.
Let us come in and praise your name, Lord.
Yeah.
Let us shout the glory.
Glory, hallelujah. You.
And Lord, we come today, Lord, on this first Sunday. This communion Sunday, Lord. To obey the ordinance that you left with us, Lord. The Lord, that we would celebrate the eating of your bread, Lord, which is your body. The drinking of the wine, which is your blood, Lord, that you shed for us. You didn't have to shed it, Lord, but you did it for one reason, that you love a wretch like me. And Lord, I thank you that you saw fit, Lord.
Yes, sir.
You saw something in me worth saving. And Lord, I'm trying to live up to that, whatever it was that you saw in me. We all here today, Lord, trying to live up to your standards, Lord, and be the people that you want us to be, Lord. Whether we be pastors, whether we be ministers, whether we be deacons, or just in the congregation, Lord. you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. And Lord, we
thank you,
Lord, and as a way to escape the things that are going on in the world.
Yes.
We know, Lord, that your presence is here, Lord.
Go ahead, man.
You may be in your presence as we glorify your name.
Done it.
My pastor couldn't have done it.
morning, Father God. We thank you this morning, Father God, for the few who are here. We thank you, Lord God, for giving them traveling grace and traveling mercy, Father God. Now that we're here, Lord God, now that we're here, Lord God, we are looking for a blessing, Father God. We ask right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Father God, touch right now your people. Touch right now your people, Father God, for we stand in the need of a blessing, Father God. We realize, Lord God, that we can't make it without you. So much is going on in this world, Father God, but we can't make it without you, Father God. So we need your guidance. We need your direction, Father God. We need your word, Father God. Oh, Lord God, we need you right now, Lord God. We need you in our homes. We need you at our jobs, Father God. We need you even right now in this church, Father God. Bless us right now, Father God. Bless us right now, Father God. We thank you, Lord God, for being a just God. We thank you, Lord God, for being a merciful God, Father. Not give us what we justly deserve. So we ask right now, so many who are sick, so many who are on their bed of affliction, but we know that you are a doctor. We know that you are a doctor who never lost a case, Father. Touch all those who are sick, Father God. Special shout out for Mama Dunham. Lord God, stop by her bedside. See about her, Father God. We know that the doctors are there caring for her. But we know, Lord God, that you are the doctor of all doctors. So we ask right now in the name of Jesus, let your will be done. Let your will be done, Father God. Lift up as only you know how. We know that you're able, Father God. You did it for Lazarus. We know you can do it for Mama Dunham, Father God. And then, Lord God, our pastor, we know his heart is heavy. His heart is heavy, Father God. Ease his troubling mind, Father. Strengthen him, Lord God, as only you know how. Strengthen the whole Dunham family, Father God. For we realize all strength and power come from you. And touch his wife. Oh, Lord God, you know about her situation. Oh, Lord God, when she go in tomorrow, Father God, you be the doctor, Father God. Lay your hands on the doctors, Father God, as they lay their hands on her, Father God. Did not wait, Lord God, you will get all the honor. You will get all the glory, Father God. For nothing is done without you. Oh, Lord God, we thank you. Thank you for sitting in the lane, Father God, to lift you up and dance. Use her in a mighty way, Father God. Let her be a testimony, Lord God, for the young folks out there. You brought her from a mighty long way, Father God, and she's still standing. So touch it right now. Touch our musicians. Touch these deacons, Lord God. Touch these preachers, Father God. Oh, Lord God. But most of all, Father God. But most of all, Father God, what we need today, we need to hear from you, Lord God. So, Lord God, touch Pastor Dunham as he stands behind your sacred desk. Oh, Lord God, bless him that he may deliver us a word that will set the captives free, Father God, that will bring sinner man to your throne of grace, your throne of mercy, Father God, for you are forgiven, God. Oh, Lord God, touch him right now, Father God. Touch him right now, Father God. Use him as a vessel, Father God. Not only for the friendship family, Lord God, but for this city, for this world, Father God. Those who are out there in social media land, Father God, let them be touched, Father. Let your word penetrate their hearts. Let your word penetrate their minds, Lord God. That they may come to you asking, Lord God, what must I do to be saved? Oh, we thank you today, Father God. We thank you for the leadership, the guidance, Father God, that you have given him. Lord God, we couldn't have made this. We couldn't have made it, Lord God, without him. The deacons couldn't have done it. We would have done our best, Father God. But we need a leader, Father God. And I thank you for the leader that you have set here at this church, Father God. Continue to hold him up. Keep him in a mighty way, Father God. Oh, we thank you, Father God. We thank you for the friendship family, for being so obedient, Father God, and so committed, Father God, and to send it in their tithes, their offerings, Father God. We know it's only possible through you, Father God. The money is good, Lord God, it's good, but we still need you. So we thank you, Father God, for using him and touching him, Father God. Thank you today, Lord God. Thank you today, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let the church say, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. He who died. Oh, yeah. Jesus who died. But he got up early Sunday morning with all power in his hand. It's in his name we tell you thank you. We tell you thank you. We love you because you first loved us. In the name of Jesus. Let the church say, amen. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Thank you, Father.
There's no one.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Oh.
Amen. Pastor.
There's no one.
There's no one like
you. There's no one like you.
There's no one like you.
Oh, oh, Jesus. How many know there's no one? There's no one like you. There's no one like you. Oh, oh. Come on, put your hands together and bless God in this house. Amen. Bless God in your house. What a wonderful day. What a great day. Thank God for our officers and a spirit-filled devotion. We want to encourage everyone. Be careful out there. Amen. We are asking you all to announce, go on your social media sites and put it out there that Friendship Baptist Church is on social media. We on Facebook this morning. We're asking you to come out with us on next Sunday on Facebook. Well, we will be crowning, no, I'm sorry, that's the third Sunday, the third Sunday. Amen. Now, Governor Newsom have opened it up that we can have church in quarantine sections. And so we'll do that on the third Sunday. We didn't do that because they opened up the salons and the barbers. This ain't for a vain reason. We doing it because the Lord led me to do it on the third Sunday. And I'm just asking us to come out. We also will be crowning two of our brothers to be deacons. Deacon Brother Cooney and Brother Pinkert. Amen. We'll be crowned on that third Sunday morning. Our chairman is going to get the place fumigated by professionals that will come and make sure and ensure that we will be safe and that we will be comfortable. But we are going to practice social distancing. We won't have a choir for a moment, but that's all right. Good foot stomping music is all right. And we all just going to be the choir. Amen. Announcement Tuesday, Mission and Brotherhood at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, all ushers will meet here at Friendship Baptist Church so as to get ourselves prepared to give directions to the congregation. We'll be doing things differently. Only one side going to come up for the offering at a time. Only one person in a restroom at a time. Families will be required to sit together. Amen. And then you're going to go into the restroom one way, but exit out the other way to make sure that you won't cross paths with each other. We're going to do all that we can. We've even got it sectioned out all the way back in the overflow. There's walking sections and there's sitting sections. And we're going to do all we can to protect the people of God. And I thank God for the officers and all of their hard work in assuring and ensuring that we're going to have a great time when we come back together. I don't know about you, but I'm getting excited already. Amen. I tell you, I saw the Garrett family and Sister Foster, and I about to jumped out of my hat. My hair almost fell out of my head. Amen. So good to see the family. Want to hug them, but I know better. Amen. Thursday night at 6 o'clock, Sister Duffel is hosting the Vacation Bible School staff. We'll meet here at the church Thursday night at 6 o'clock. And then Friday night is our Winning Souls for Christ. Mark your calendars, the 28th will be our student promotion. And then July 19th, Sister Huntley will be circulating information regarding our Women's Day celebration. It will be at 9:30 in the morning. We can't invite other churches. They won't be inviting us as well, because we're going to be practicing social distancing. Isn't God wonderful? I don't know about you, but I don't know what I would do without the Lord. Amen. Keep my mom in prayer. She still is in the hospital, but the good news is that we cannot, and I know it's horrible, but the good news is that we cannot go see her. Amen. It becomes bad news when they want us there, because it's the last visitation. And so we understand it. It hurts. This is very unique. My mom was a sociable person, and so my heart is heavy, but I know what God is able to do, and I know what God has done. I know what he don't do is because he don't want done. And so just ask you to keep on praying for my mom. Pray for the Cooney family. She did lose her niece in Washington. And then pray for Sister Duffel. She lost her brother. Amen. Amen. We're going to receive the offering now. Amen. And then we'll be blessed with a dance selection. Amen. We're blessed with a dance selection. Amen. We have a great fellowship. A great fellowship. I got a lot to be thankful to God for. Talked with Dr. R.A. Williams this week, yesterday, matter of fact. And he said that church, and I agreed with him, the church will never be what it used to be to some people. But to us that know the Lord, we still have a church. Amen. They might have separated us, but they ain't took the church away from us. Do I have a witness here? Amen. Amen. Brother officers, I left all of those tithes and offering. Amen. Please. Amen. You do know I'm 65.
I'm right behind you, Pastor. Amen. That's just only fitting to what I'm about to say. Most of you have already sent your tithes in. Amen. Through
thank
Give
you.
The Fly, that
you're right,
PayPal
you're
app.
Thank you. You're right.
PayPal you're right. app. And some are even coming up right now. But actually, these trays are practically full already. Amen.
Isn't God good?
And we just come before God's altar, you know, to thank him and to thank you for sending your tithes in and bringing your tithes in.
Very faithful.
Amen. Here comes Sister Monte with another stack.
Yes, sir.
So this is what God can do when you have good leadership. Amen. Dr. Dunham not only preach the word, teach the word, but he lives the word. And I think that's good. Amen. Amen. We thank God for you, Pastor. Amen. Amen. We're going. Oh, this is the first Sunday. We normally take up consecrated quarters. Amen. So when you come back the next first Sunday, there should be a whole lot of consecrated quarters. Amen. Amen. We, Eternal God, our Father, we come once again, Father God, to tell you thank you. Thank you, Father God, for allowing us just to give back a small portion to what you have given us. We ask right now in the name of Jesus that you would take it, you would multiply it, Father God, for the upbuilding of thy kingdom. We thank you for the gift. We thank you for the giver. But most of all, Father God, we thank you for your son, Jesus, Father God. It's in his name we tell you thank you, thank you, and amen. Amen.
We are just so happy that we have some graduates. Amen. We wanted to congratulate and celebrate with Sister Amaya Dees, graduated from Fleming Island High School. Then Sister Ariana Hill, graduated from Berkeley High School. Sister Irea Johnson, graduated from York High School. Brother Deontay Williams, graduated from Hartnell College. Junior Deacon Timothy Harper, graduated from Monterey Peninsula College. Brother Gabriel Howard, graduated from Fresno Pacific College. Junior Deacon Dante Duffel, graduated from San Jose State University. And Brother Aaron Bibbins II, graduated from San Francisco State University. Give them a big hand. Let's celebrate and congratulate. Then, Sister Delana Foster's coming now.
Beside still waters, he restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right, and sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past, hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister Leandria here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
Put your hands together and bless God in this house. Bless God in your house. Thank Sister Foster for dancing. This is my Exodus. I'm getting out of this mess. To the officers and to our ministers and to each of you, my father's children, it's good just to be here one more time. We give God all of the glory, honor, and the praise. We are, let's stand for a word of prayer, and we're going to get right into the message. Father, we thank you today for all of your many blessings and for your tender mercies. We ask, Father, for forgiveness of all of our many sins, and that you would own and love us as your children. Give us a word today. Speak to us and through us. Use us as an instrument of honor, that blinded eyes will be opened and hearts of stone will be receptive, that your word will go forth and find fertile ground, and then save a soul, set a captive free. Give us the victory. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus, for this hour. Amen and amen. If you would, go with me with Daniel. We're going to leave the book of John for a minute. I want to look in the book of Daniel. The sixth chapter of the book of Daniel. The sixth chapter, began reading in verse number 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his own house, and windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. Thank you. So reads the word of God. I'd like to talk from that topic, the power of a bowed knee. The power of a bowed knee. Daniel, the prophet, is living in a situation very similar to our present condition. Daniel was held in captivity. He and all of Israel had been banished by King Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians out of Jerusalem, but they were banished by the hand of God. It was God's hand that put Israel in time out. Israel, because of her own attitude towards God, was now living under punishment that had been authorized by God. Israel was under quarantine. They were displaced from Jerusalem. They were restrained from their holy land, Jerusalem. Israel was unable to feel the love of brotherly kindness. Israel could not experience the joy of fellowship of brothers and sisters in worship. The ability to gather at the altar had been removed. But though Israel couldn't get back to the holy city, it did not stop Daniel from bowing on his knees and praying to his God. And that is because there is power when we bow down in prayer. Of course, over the last several weeks, we have been experiencing some after effects of a fallout of a man by the name of Mr. Derek Chauvin, who bowed his knees on the neck of Brother Floyd, causing Brother Floyd to asphyxiate, resulting in Floyd's losing his life. I never knew the strength of a physical bow. I've never known what it was to bow it physically and destroy a man because of hatred, because of prejudice. A bowed knee took a man's life because of prejudice. But I'm a preacher, and I'm here to tell you that a bowed knee will do way more than take a life. A bowed knee will bring about life. I wish I had a witness here. A bowed knee will do things for you that nobody else can do. My daddy used to always say, a pastor can see further on his knees than he can standing on his tiptoes. In this text this morning, we encounter the prophet Daniel, a prayer warrior if there ever was one. Daniel never allowed his position to lift his head up above his God. All too often we think we are who we are. We think we are what we possess. We think that people think about us, about what we have, because we get intoxicated by our stuff. We get intoxicated. We get what I call swollen head because we got more money in the bank than somebody else. But I'm here to tell you, don't let your success become intoxication, because it will become a stumbling block before your God. You got to learn how to say, any way you bless me, I'm sure enough satisfied. Daniel had been exalted to a great position, but thank God his soul prospered as well. Daniel was a man of an excellent spirit and a powerful prayer life. Three times a day he bowed in prayer. Therefore, his head did not become inflated. Martin Luther declared that all of the greatness of the world ain't no more than a bone that God throws to a dog. The example of Daniel that we're presenting this morning is something that's going to help us understand that there's power in prayer. When you bow down your knees, you ought to be able to call on your Heavenly Father. My first point is Daniel's devotion. Daniel had a habit. And we all got habits. The trouble is, habits are addictive. Daniel's habit was devotion. Daniel had what you can call a prayer appointment. Israel is quarantined. Israel done got beat up by the Babylonians. Israel has looked like God has vacated them. God let Babylon destroy them. God let Babylon go into the temple and take the vessels out of the temple. And here this man is, bowing, talking to the God. You know how some of us are. If you do us wrong, if we think you did us wrong, we're going to turn our back on you. Somebody done thought God done them wrong, and they done stopped praying. They done stopped calling on God. I'm here to tell you, God didn't do you wrong. You left God, and so God paid you. I wish I had a witness here. Daniel had a habit. I don't care what comes
my way. I've got so much to pray for. He prayed for himself. He was hurting. His heart was heavy. He prayed for his people. The people that were so prosperous, but now they are slaves. He prayed that when they were in bondage, that God would remember them. He prayed for people who are bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. He prayed for Jerusalem, that once was the joy of the whole wide world, now lays in waste. He prayed for their return from captivity. He prayed for the glory of God. You ought to have a prayer appointment. You ought to be able to have somebody you can pray for. You ought to go down on your knees and talk to God about your problem. Talk to God about what you're going. He had a prayer appointment. But then I like the text says he also had a praise anointment. The Bible said he prayed and gave thanks. Thanks! It's a pitiful prayer that's always begging and never saying thank you. You know it's bad whenever a parent got to keep telling the same child, say thank you. Say thank you. Say thank you. By the first or second one, you ought to go and put some. Teach them the value of receiving. That's why when they receive something from God, they don't know how to say thank you. They won't even tell you thank you. We got to learn how to tell God thank you. I can't live in God's blessings. I can't live in the favor of God. I wake up in the morning and look and see my family well. I got food on my plate. I can eat beans in the morning and beans in the afternoon and beans in the middle of the night. And I got a right to tell my God, thank you. Got a car I can drive. Got my health and my strength. And I ought to be able to tell him, thank you. Prayer of thanksgiving. A praise anointment. When you go down there, learn how to tell God, thank you. I know he's been good to you because I'm looking at you. I know he's brought you a mighty. I wish I had a witness here. Prayer appointment and a praise anointment, but then swiftly a positive attitude. Look at that little word. He prayed and gave thanks to his God. His God. He did not merely say the God of my fathers, but he gave thanks to his God. God was and he is his. Doesn't that blow your mind? I can understand if God, you can claim God as your God and you're in the palace. You eating bread. I understand he's your God and you riding in a Bentley. But here he was in captivity, separated from his loved one. Here he was under the care of some enemy of God. And yet he bows and says, thank you. Pitiful. Yeah, some of us are so pitiful. Don't know how to say thank you. We walk into a refrigerator full of food, full of vegetables and milk and meat in every tray, and still holler, I ain't got nothing to eat. Don't know how to say thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Learn how to have a positive attitude. Learn how to have a positive, tell him. And then not only prayer anointment, praise of anointment and positive attitude, but have a posture of adoration. When he prayed, he got down to pray.
remember the story about Hezekiah, when he got sick under death, he turned his face to the wall and he prayed. Some of y'all remember Daniel when he got David, when he was on his way out, he sat up and he prayed. But when you in private with God, Daniel bowed down on his knees and then placed his face on the floor. Now what you have to understand is he's under the authority of the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar. He's submissive to Nebuchadnezzar, but in prayer he's saying that I'm submissive to my God, that my God is my king. I don't care what's going on around me. God is my king. That's Daniel's devotion. Let me look real quickly. There needs to be some daring in danger. Daniel went up to pray and opened his windows. He heard about the edict. Heard about the danger. And every day, in the morning, in the noon, and in the night, and he bowed. He opened his window. Listen, he didn't care who heard him. He didn't care what they said or what they were going to tell on him. He opened his window towards Jerusalem, which really says that he don't care what they hear, because he wasn't talking to them. His conversation went past his enemy to heaven and to God's. I wish I had a witness here. We spend so much time worrying about other folk that we forget we ain't talking to them. We're not trying to impress you when we pray. Prayer meeting needs to be filled for you to learn how to pray. You ought not be intimidated because somebody prays better than you. They don't pray better than you unless you say so. Because the prayer is going to one person, God Almighty. The prayer is not to be addressed to your brothers and your sisters. Open up your window and let the prayer flow. He prayed to Jerusalem because it was to remind him of the goodness of God, to remind him of the beauty of God, to remind him of what Solomon had already set forth. Solomon said, if your people get in trouble, will you hear them? If they turn their face to Jerusalem, and then if they bow down and pray, will you hear them and will you heal the land? And God said, yes, he would. So the direction was for God to hear, but then listen at the disregard. Daniel made up in his mind he ain't gonna change his routine. He said, I'm gonna pray no matter what nobody say. He knew that talk would be lost on his enemy, so he didn't even tell them why he was praying. See, there's some folk you're gonna have to totally disregard. If I can only get believers to disregard haters, your life would be a whole lot more fuller. If you learn how to stop pleasing your haters, if you learn how to ignore what folk feel about you, who care how they feel about you? They don't even pay rent to be on your mind. They don't pay no lease to occupy your heart. They disregard them.
You don't owe them nothing. Was the direction as a disregard, but didn't look at the directly. He went immediately. He didn't pause. He didn't ask what y'all think I ought to do. He didn't bow where he was, hiding in a corner. But where he was, he went to his special place. And he had no time to reason whether he's supposed to pray. He just knew he had to get to where he was supposed to pray. When Daniel heard what the king's edict said, nobody gonna pray for 30 days. Nobody gonna be able to go to there. Nobody can talk to their God for 30 days. He didn't wait 21 days. He didn't wait 29 days. He didn't wait one day. Right away, directly, he went to pray. Some of us got to learn how to stop and pray. Stop and praying, but keep on praying. Stop praying. Keep on praying. Don't you know you can pray your way through your struggle? Don't you know you can pray your way through your pain? Don't you know you got power in your prayer? You got heaven's attention when you bow down in prayer. Pray. Seek the face of God. Direction disregarded directly. Then fourthly, let me just talk real quickly about dependable. Daniel was dependable. The text says, as he had did aforetime. He been doing it. He God can count on him to bow three times. Daniel don't make no alteration. Same place, same hour, same posture, same position, same spirit. Daniel prayed. This indicates to you and I that under Christian persecution, we ain't got no business to stop doing what we do. We ought to know that we can depend on God. The thing ain't if you can depend on God. The thing is, can God depend on you? Can God count on you to tithe? Can God count on you to love your neighbor? Can God count on you to do good to them that despitefully mistreat you? Can God count on you to be a witness? Can God count on you to worship and praise? Can God count on? Not about whether we can count on him, because God is dependable. But God wants you to be dependable. Ain't nothing worse than somebody who you can't count on. You ask where you're going, you're going to be here, and they're everywhere but where you're supposed to be. That's like trying to lay a bet on how far a one-legged man can kick a football. He's undependable. But God wants us to be dependable. Don't let persecution stop you. Don't let trouble stop you. Don't let pain stop you. As Daniel's devotion, daring in danger. But thirdly and finally, can I talk about declaration of dependence? Something in Daniel gave Daniel backbone. There's a reason that Daniel had strength in this struggle. When I recall the events of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, on July 4th, 1776. The declaration explained why the 13 colonies were at war with the Kingdom of Great Britain, because they regarded themselves as 13 independent sovereign states no longer under British rule. With the declaration that these new states took a collective first step toward forming the United States of America. The declaration was signed by representatives declaring their declaration of independence. But here Daniel is setting forth a declaration of dependence. He's saying, I can't make it without God. I got to talk to him, whether you want me to or not. I got to hear from him, whether you believe it or not, whether you think I ought to or not. I've got to declare that I need it. And I ought to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people up in here who know I need him every day of my life. Daniel had personal history. Daniel had seen Nebuchadnezzar defied already. Daniel had beheld the Son of God walking in the furnace with the three Hebrew boys. He had smelled the movement of God throughout Old Testament history. Daniel had personal experience with God. It was Daniel that faced King Belshazzar when the thousands of guests were shouting to their gods and dancing and prancing with the king, his wives, and his concubines, drinking out of the cups that had been consecrated to Jehovah. Daniel stood tall as the fingers of the wall wrote against the wall, many, many tekel upharsin. It was a doom proclaimed against the king. Daniel looked in the face of God, and then he looked in the face of them lions, and he said, y'all can't do nothing but eat me. Hey, I'm gonna keep on talking to my. He had experience that strengthened him personally. But besides that, Daniel had not only personal history, he had his story. Daniel had his. He had the work of God moving on the behalf of the children of Israel. Daniel remembered when water gushed from a rock in a desert. Daniel remembered the hand of God, the work of God, the move of God in the life of Israel. And Daniel got calm assurance because his God can do anything. But somebody needs to hear this morning. God can still deliver you. But if he does not deliver you, it's not that he's not able to, but it's because he don't want to. Then I'm satisfied that whatever God does is for my good. Somebody needs to hear that God is able. Can I get a witness here? Well, many have said that we will follow the Lord with all of our heart. Well, they will be satisfied with Daniel. Yeah, God was satisfied with Daniel. Yeah. The life that he lived and the prayer
that he offered. Can I get a witness? But when, yeah, Daniel was thrown into the lion's den, it was prayer that got Daniel, got him thrown in the lion's den. But then it was prayer that got Daniel delivered out of the lion's den. Can I get a witness here? Thank God that my brothers and my sisters, you may find yourself in hot water on your job. You may find yourself in hot water on your marriage. But I dare you today, just take a little talk with Jesus, because he will make everything all right. When you pray, then let him have his way. It is because you can't hurry God. No, no, you just have to wait. Trust him and give him time, no matter how long it takes. Yeah, he's a God that you can't hurry. He'll be there, don't you worry. He may not come when you want him, but can I get a witness here? He will, yeah, show up on time. Oh yes, he will, because he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. How do you know that Jesus is an on-time God? Well, it is because, yes, when Daniel prayed, it did not prevent him from being thrown in a lion's den. Yes, it did not stop Daniel from letting a stone be put over his only exit out of the lion's den. It did not stop the seal from being pressed upon the stone that keep him on the inside alone. But can I tell you that because Daniel prayed, something happened in that den. You know, theologians say that Daniel is a type of Christ. I gotta leave you here, because just like Daniel, Jesus had enemies. Jesus had some haters that tried to destroy him. Well, just like Daniel, they brought sedition charges against an innocent man. Yeah, but the difference is, from the courtroom, Daniel was thrown in a lion's den. But Jesus, good God Almighty, had a change of direction on that Friday. His change started. Yeah, they whipped him all night Thursday. They slapped him all night Thursday. But Friday, they nailed his hands to a rugged cross. Can I get a witness here? Friday, they speared my Jesus in the side. Thank God, all right. Thank you, Lord, for that Friday. Anybody know he died for the sins of the world? Friday, good God Almighty, he died. Friday, he died. Dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. They sealed the tomb with a rock and then put a signet on the side of the rock. Jesus stayed there in that grave until Sunday morning. Early, early, early. Sunday morning. Early. Good God Almighty. Early. Sunday morning. He got up with all power in his hand. And that's why I can bow down in prayer, because they got all power. That's why I can call on him when my trouble comes, because they got all power. That is why I can be lied on, because they got all power. That is why I can be hated because I'm a black man in America, because he's got all power. When my God gets tired of you putting your knee upon my neck, he will. I wish I had a witness. Israel waited 400 years for Egypt to take their knee off of their neck. And 400 years, God heard them and answered their prayer. So I don't mind waiting my time, because when God, good God Almighty, when God get through, when God get tired, he will. Yes, sir. Help me shout, he will. He will. Yes, he will. He'll set us free. Ain't he all right? Is there anybody that knows it's all right? Say yes. Say yes. Say yes. Ain't he good? I say, ain't he good? Ain't he good? Ain't he good? He's good. Yes! He's good. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and mercy. Thank you for all of your many blessings. Thank you for tender mercies. Thank you for keeping us today. In spite of all the corona, in spite of all the marching, hatred, thank you for keeping us, not allowing us to lose our cool, knowing that we've got every right to call on your name. Our position is not pride, but our position is prayer. Thank you, Father, that we've got a God who's able. Bless right now, we'll give you glory, honor, and praise. Send forth laborers into your harvest. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Amen and amen. Bless God, will you? Thank the Lord for another privilege to be in his house. But there's somebody who's on the outside of the ark of safety. Somebody's lost and on their way to hell. I dare not close up a message, close up a service without allowing somebody to be saved. That's what it's all about. God allowed you this moment
so that you would be saved. Yes, Jesus died for the sins of the whole world, but only those who will personally appropriate Jesus as their Lord and Savior will reap the benefits of the blood on the cross. It's a simple process. I try to make it as easy as I can. If you will, A, acknowledge that you're a sinner. If you can acknowledge that Christ, that you can't be saved aside from Christ, then B, you gotta believe that his blood paid the price of your sins, paid the ransom that every man, woman, boy, and girl born received. We were born in sin, shaping in iniquity. So Christ's blood would pay. If you believe his blood paid your price, and then C, confess your will to his will. Surrender yourself to his will for your life. If you will confess Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are saved. And if that's you today, if that's you, please let us know. Write us a letter. Address it to the church, 1440 Broadway Avenue, Seaside, California. And just let us know that the preacher was talking to you. If you want to just give us a call, leave us your name, we'll be glad to report that to the church. The phone number to call is 831-394-2966. And we want to give a salvation report with your name on it. If you authentically admit your sin, believe in Christ paying your ransom, and then confessing him as your Lord and Savior. If you do that, we want to announce you and welcome you into the family of God. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you for being with us. We're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. We're going to ask you to stay online. We're going to come down and position ourselves. We're going to read our church covenant first, and then we'll have our prayer. Amen. And then we will move right into church covenant is on the screen there. I can't see your eyes. Amen. Thank you. The church covenant says, having been led, as we believe, by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. We do now, in the presence of God, angels, and this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. To promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines. To contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel to all nations. So engage to maintain family and secret devotions, to religiously educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances.
To walk circumspectly in the world.
Yeah.
To be just in our feelings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment.
To avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger.
To abstain from sale and abuse of intoxicating drinks and of beverage, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Lord Savior.
We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love.
To remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate peace and Christian sympathy and feeling, and courtesy and empathy.
to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure it without delay. Moreover, engage that when we remove from this place, we will, as soon as possible, unite with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. Our Father and our God, we thank you now for all of your many blessings. We ask you now to forgive us of all of our many sins. Own and love us as your child. Oh God, allow us to receive this without incurring the curse. Truly, we honor you and give you the glory. In Jesus' name, thank you, Father. Amen and amen.
Once again, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, he who died but yet still lives, Father God. Thank you, Lord God, for another privilege and an opportunity, Lord God, to partake in one of your ordinances, Father God, the Lord's Supper. We thank you, Lord God, for Jesus, who you sent down to be beat on, to be lied on, Father God, just for me. We thank you for the broken body, Lord God. We thank you for the pain that he had to endure, for he did it all for me. And I tell you, thank you this morning, Father God. As we eat of this bread, Father God, which represents his body, we ask, Lord God, that we will search our hearts and we will search our minds, Father God, to be mindful not to take this unworthily. For your word says, many are asleep because they have taken this unworthily, Father God. Forgive us right now of all of our many sins and our many transgressions. Let us take this, Father God, in a holy manner. It's in the name of Jesus we tell you, thank you, and amen.
Our God and our Father, Lord, you took the cup, and you said, do this as often in remembrance of you. You took the cup, oh God, and you said, this is the blood that I have shed for many. We know, Lord, that this is the blood, but we do this symbolically in remembrance of you. And Father, we come to say thank you. Oh God, it's been all month long, and you allowed us to come again to partake in this Lord's Supper. Many of us over the airways have not got sick, and many of us not have got the COVID, or Lord, the city's in rage and protests is everywhere. And Lord, you protected us. And Lord, we come and with an open heart. And Lord, we come as humble as we can, and we want to say thank you, oh God. Thank you for what you've done. Lord, up on Calvary many years ago, it was by your blood when they beat you, oh God. And Lord, you never said a mocking word. And Lord, that's why we're here today, because of your blood. And Lord, we want to say thank you. We don't do this kindly, oh God. Lord, we ask you, please, let your blood go forth. Help those that don't know you, oh God. But as we take part in this, oh God, we say thank you. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for your son. Thank you, oh God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Yes. Everybody, thank you, sir. Amen. I was going to get y'all good. Oh, what a blessing. What a blessing to be able to have the Lord's Supper. We thank God for allowing us to do this the COVID way. It is our prayer that in this quarantine we've seen God. I've seen growth in many of the church, and I'm grateful to get to that. Amen. That same night that he was betrayed, Jesus. They betrayed Jesus. He took him up in a large upper room. He says, you know, I knew you were going to do this. And so this is going to be my last time that I'm going to be able to eat with you. He took the bread and he broke it and said, this is going to represent my body. Body going to be broken, beaten, bloodied, and battered just for you. He said, and he took the fruit of the cup and said, this is going to represent my blood that's going to be shed for you, which represents blood of the New Testament. As often as you take this, you show my death and burial until I come again. And Christ is coming again. He's quicker now than he was 10 years ago. Thank God for that. And they all ate together. Thank you, Brother Chairman. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Wow. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross, and I know what love. I know it was, hallelujah, I know it was, oh yeah, I know one blood for, oh, one day I was lost, he died upon the cross, I know one. Well, they crucified my love. They crucified my love. They crucified my Lord for me. Oh, one day I'm alone. He died upon the cross. Thank you. My Lord for me. Thank you. We also wanted to congratulate the graduation of Brother Terrell Smith from Carlton J. Kell High School in Marietta, Georgia. This is Brother Curtis Smith, who was here 20 plus years ago that had that electrical accident, but God blessed him to carry on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Congratulations to Brother Terrell Smith. All minds are clear. Hallelujah. Amen. God is good. Amen. Amen. Sister Foster is working, and we thank God for you. We wish everyone would get busy online with classes. Amen. Learn what you can. It's going to be a blessing to you. All minds are clear. Usher meeting, thank you. Tuesday night, usher meeting at 7 o'clock. Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, usher meeting. And then Vacation Bible School staff on Thursday night. Father, we thank you for all of your many blessings and your tender mercies. Continue to have your way, protect us as we go out into this environment, watch over us and keep us. But use us as a witness. Help us to testify of your goodness. Give us the power to win a soul just for thee. Thank you, Master, for just this day. Now unto him is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and evermore. Let the church say amen, amen, and amen. Go with God and go in peace is our prayer for you.